Primero, pues dar las gracias a la FUNSEM en la persona de su director general, Juan Batalla, por la oportunidad de que EDPR pudiera pues, ser el host, no lo sé decir en castellano, de este seminario de primavera, aunque esté nevando en Madrid, ¿no? Sí. Entonces, y también a María Teresa Costa, una de las mentoras de FUNSEM, ¿no? Muchas gracias y gracias a todos por estar aquí. Como sabemos, la directiva europea que se llama Winter Package o paquete de invierno establece un nuevo marco regulatorio y salió en noviembre del año pasado. Y un par de notitas que gustaríamos de mencionar para pues, ayudar o contribuir para la mejora de este marco, ¿no? La mejora del gobierno o del modelo de gobierno es algo que creemos que es fundamental, principalmente también la capacidad de monitorarlo de forma cercana para protección de la estabilidad de las inversiones, sean las actuales o las futuras, y también el asegurar el compliance o la conformidad por parte de los Estados miembros con los compromisos que han sido hechos. También creemos que tener una visibilidad en el pricing o en el precio es crítica, en particular para la financiación, y perdonar porque esto es parte que me toca de cerca, ¿no? De cualquier proyecto, ¿no? Entonces, pues subastas o concursos con visibilidad de los llamados long-term PPAs son, en nuestra opinión, bastante importantes para que todos los stakeholders consigan llegar a sus retornos definidos. Pero para detallar un poco más lo que es el Clean Energy for All, tenemos con nosotros a Sofía Pinto Barbosa, que es la de la Comisión Europea y que agradecemos o damos las gracias por su presencia. Tiene un vasto conocimiento, experiencia, con un enfoque en gestión de riesgo, de mercado de capitales, energía y regulación. Así que, pasando la palabra a Juan.
Sí. Miguel, muchas gracias. Buenas tardes a todos. La verdad es que es un placer volvernos a ver ya en este 2017, reiniciando lo que es el ciclo de seminarios de FUNSEAM. Agradecer especialmente, en este caso, a EDP Renovables, en la persona de Miguel y de todo el equipo, Jorge, Rafael, Arturo y seguro que muchos otros que han hecho posible que hoy tenga lugar este seminario. Agradeceros vuestra colaboración para que estos seminarios tengan lugar y, sobre todo, para convertirse en este pues, punto de encuentro para poder debatir con representantes de este nivel temas de gran relevancia. No me voy a extender, pero sí que me gustaría el tema de apuntar que con este segundo seminario cerraríamos lo que es este miniciclo que hicimos para abordar el Winter Package. Recordaréis que en el anterior tuvimos a Paula Piño para dar una visión más general de lo que eran los contenidos del paquete legislativo. En este segundo seminario hemos considerado de gran relevancia, teniendo en cuenta el papel que van a desempeñar las renovables en ese proceso de transición energética hacia una economía descarbonizada, pues poder abordar en más detalle dentro de lo que es el Winter Package, la directiva de renovables y los aspectos más relevantes. En este sentido contamos, como decía Miguel, contamos hoy con Sofía, que es partícipe de este proyecto, es una gran experta en mercados de capital, mercados energéticos, y a la que le agradecemos que con su complicada agenda nos haya hecho un hueco pues, para venir hoy con nosotros aquí en Madrid y nos pueda pues, dar su visión y después posterior debate con el que podremos seguramente entrar en más detalle en aquellas cuestiones que estiméis más interesantes o más necesarias de profundizar. Sin más, Sofía, muchas gracias de nuevo y te doy la palabra. Gracias.
Muchas gracias. I am very sorry. I would really like to do this in Spanish, but unfortunately my Portuñol is not that good. And so I have to continue in English. First of all, I would like to say that I would like to thank Joan, Miguel, and Maria Teresa Costa for this invitation, for this opportunity. The European Commission thanks for giving us the opportunity to present what are the main goals underlying our clean energy package and what we aim to achieve. So today, in our session, I will try to present what the clean energy package is about, with a special focus on renewables. And so, first of all, why do we need this package? And we need this package first because we have to deliver on the commitments on the Paris Agreement, and also on the targets that were established by the EU Council in 2014, which established at least to achieve a 27% renewable share, a 27% energy efficiency target, and a 40% reduction of emissions by 2030. So this is one of the goals of the package, but also because we really have to adapt our system for the energy of tomorrow. The energy system of tomorrow will be different. We expect already in 2030 to have a 50% renewable share of electricity. And this puts a lot of stress on our framework, which has to adapt to it. And so basically our clean energy package will focus on three main elements. First, putting energy efficiency first. And why is this? Well, the cheapest form of energy is the one which is not consumed, but also because energy efficiency can be a very important element to reduce import, to reduce our input bill in fuels, and also to target energy poverty through buildings. Second, we want to continue to be world leaders in renewables. And why? Not only because of the benefits of decarbonization, but also because this can bring a lot of growth and job opportunities. And third, we will focus also our package in the consumer. The consumer of tomorrow, and already this is a trend today, is a consumer with digital applications who can consume his energy, who can connect to the grid. And so it is very important to have to adapt all our system to allow all this, to bring forward all this. First, we have to set the right regulatory framework. And the regulatory framework which we put in place with the clean energy package is focused on five basic pillars. We have at the top the energy union governance. Here, in the with the energy union governance, member states will have to adopt national energy action plans covering the five dimensions of energy, so energy efficiency, renewables, security of supply. And this energy union governance will ensure that member states and collectively the EU will achieve the targets. The package is also about revising the Energy Efficiency Directive. And here we will have a collective EU binding target of achieving 30% of reductions of energy efficiency. But also we will have an adaptation of the Energy Performance of Buildings Directives, because we want to have the decarbonization of buildings until 2050. Then we also have to adapt the Renewables Directive, not only to achieve the 27%, but also because the market has changed and we need to have the markets fit for renewables and renewables fit for market. And another very important aspect is the new electricity market design. Here we are talking about the electricity market governance regulation, but also the electricity directive. And this is essential so that the markets become fit for renewables, and that renewables can also get a higher fraction of their revenues through the market. And then we also have the energy prices and costs reports, which was just published, and which gives an idea of the prices that we pay in Europe for all member states, divided in taxes, the levies, the wholesale prices, and how we perform with regards to our competitors. So basically, this is a regulatory framework which we have put in place. But I would also like to refer that the proposals were made based on many impact assessments, the inputs of stakeholders, so that we could take into account the cost-effective deployment of the solutions that we are proposing. Another, besides the regulatory package, we also have the enabling environment for post-2020. And this, what is this? So basically, the Commission wants to link its proposals in terms of regulations with other priorities which are being carried out under the Commission. And here I would like to highlight two of them. The first one is the link to the better use of public funds. So here the Commission will address through financial instruments and through structural funds the best ways in order to ensure the right that the right investments are put in place, and this can be a very important tool for member states to take up the investments. And another important aspect is also delivering on the key energy infrastructure projects, such as the PCIs. But also another important aspect is to, in terms of digitalization, how we can combine the adaption of our energy system to the digitalization, which is occurring, which is mainstreamed in the economy. And what can we expect in terms of results? Well, this is not only about targets. This will represent also additional investment. We are talking about 177 billion euros per year, a 1% increase in GDP by 2013, and the creation of new jobs in the market, up to 900,000. 72% of share of non-fossil fuels in electricity generation in 2030. This is what we expect to achieve in 2030. And so how does it look like? Well, this is a picture. A picture is worth 1,000 words. So this is the set of the whole package, the impact assessments, 8 legislative proposals, REFIT consultations, stakeholders. This is what the package is about. So basically, I would like to tell you that many colleagues, hundreds of colleagues in the European Commission have been putting all their efforts, listening to all types of stakeholders in order to deliver a package which will indeed allow us to take up the most of this energy transition. Starting now with renewables. So what is the context today? Well, today already more than 1 million people work in the renewable energy sector, and we expect this to increase to up to 3 million jobs up to 2030. I'm sorry, the number here is wrong. Also, this means more business. For instance, I don't know if you know, but today 30% of world renewables patents are European. Renewables today also represent a very important savings in terms of fossil fuels and energy imports. With what we achieve today, we could cut fossil fuels by the equivalent of Poland's entire annual energy consumptions. And today, the situation is very different than in 2009 when we launched the Renewables Directive, because renewables are today affordable. They are much cheaper, and they are already at competing costs with fossil fuel technologies. For instance, in the PV solar panels, we saw a decrease of 5 times the price. and offshore wind is already meeting its targets for 2020. We had impressive, last year we had impressive auctions, the Kriegers Flak at 50 euros per megawatt hour, the onshore wind, and also a 72 megawatt hours for a wind project in Netherlands. So this means that renewables now are really a cost-effective way to decarbonize our economy. I would also like to mention that our regulatory framework and our policy has been leading worldwide. Today, already 173 countries have renewable energy targets. Well, in 2005, this was only 25 countries with these targets. And the results are there. Today, we have already reached 17% of a renewables share, and so we are on track to achieve the 2020 target. Giving a little bit more detail of our progress towards national RES targets, last month, we have just published our progress report, which states that as I've just mentioned, we are on track to achieving our target. In 2015, 11 member states had already reached their 2020 targets. We're talking about Bulgaria, Czech Republic, Denmark, Hungary, Italy, Lithuania, Finland, Sweden, and Denmark. All but once a member state showed average 2013-2014 shares which were equal or higher than their corresponding indicative red trajectory. 25 member states in 2015-2016 had also exceeded their indicative red trajectories. But this is not good news for everyone. So by 2020, there are four countries which might miss the target. And so this means that they will have to enter into cooperation mechanisms. And these countries are Ireland, Luxembourg, the Netherlands, and the United Kingdom. And so after giving this context of where we stand today in terms of renewables, let me say what are our key objectives for the period after 2020. And I think that the first main objective is to address investment certainty. Renewables many times have a huge cost of capital, have very high upfront capital costs. And so this is a key element that we must address. And so we want to address investment certainty by ensuring that we put in place a stable regulatory framework which investors can trust. The second objective is the cost-effective deployment of renewables. Today, the focus has not moved from moving from a technological breakthrough as we needed in 2009, but today the focus is how to integrate renewables into the market and develop renewables in the most efficient way. So we want renewables to be deployed in the best locations, and we also want to see that consumers can see the benefits of the energy transition in their bills. Another objective is to tap heating and cooling potential. This is a sector which consumes 50% of the energy consumption, but where RES are not advancing as quickly as for the electricity. Today, this sector only has an 18% share of renewables. And if we want to reach the 27% target in 2030 in a cost-effective way, we must have measures. In this sector. And for the first time, this sector we have included measures for heating and cooling alongside transport and electricity. Another objective is to promote innovation in transport. This is also a sector which is lagging behind with 6% of renewable shares, and where conventional biofuels have proven to have an ILUC impact, which we need to mitigate. And last but not least, the post-2020 implies a major change. Until 2020, we had national binding targets for member states. And after 2020, the EU must reach collectively a share of at least 27%. And so this poses many challenges on how we will ensure that this will happen. We also want to have a more even deployment across member states. And why is this? Well, investments are increasingly concentrated in a few member states. Germany and UK accounted for 2/3 of the investments in renewables during 2013 and 2015. Also, in the analysis we made in our impact assessment, we saw that if we opened up to a EU cooperation and moving from national support schemes to a EU type of support with an underlying same cost of capital, the savings achieved could be immense. For instance, this would mean changing investments, this would mean lowering the investment needs from 404 billion euros to 140 billion euros. And at the same time, this would mean that more member states would participate in this decarbonization. So the three member states with a current framework as today, the three top member states would cover a share of 67% of renewables. If we move to a more Europeanized approach, this share would lower to 47%. So I think it was an important outcome of our impact assessment, which indeed shows that if we act collectively, if we act in a European way, we will be able to achieve savings, and this has benefits for our consumers and for our energy bills. And so, before moving to the specific measures of the Renewables Directive, I would like to highlight the following. The renewables framework cannot be only viewed in terms of the recast of the Renewables Directive. Why? Because the whole energy package has many elements which will feed into the framework of renewables. And here I would like to highlight three. The electricity regulation. The electricity regulation is essential and is key to have markets that integrate better the renewables, this variable shares. I would like to highlight also the electricity directive, which has many important provisions for consumers, as consumers are put in the at the center of our goals. And as I already mentioned, the governance regulation. So the governance regulation will be the overarching regulation which will ensure that member states are delivering on what they have committed, and will give the will not only ensure that they are delivering, but they will alert for eventual EU measures or other measures in case we are falling behind the achievement of our targets. Then you also have the EPBD and the EED, the Energy Efficiency Directive and the Energy Performance of Buildings Directive, which are not so directly linked with our directive, with the Renewables Directive, unless we take into account the building sector. So this is the Energy Efficiency Directive and the Energy Performance Building Directive is also very important towards setting the strategy to the decarbonization of buildings until 2050. And so our proposal, we think that our proposal delivers a well-balanced measures across sectors, measures for increasing renewable electricity, decarbonizing heating and cooling, empowering consumers for the target achievement of the 27%, removing also administrative barriers, and strengthening EU sustainability criteria. Let's start by electricity. Where we are and where we need to go. So we started off in 2005 with a 15% share of renewable electricity in the EU energy consumption, and today we have almost reached 28%, and we aim to reach 36% by 2020. In 2030, half of the electricity will be provided by renewable renewables, and in 2050 this share will even increase to 66%. So 2/3 of our electricity will be renewables. And why is this? Well, the electricity sector is one of the easiest sectors to decarbonize, and for this reason it will have to bear the brunt of the efforts. And so what are we proposing in order to in fact achieve this half of electricity through renewables? Well, I would say that for electricity there are two main set of provisions which will foster renewable electricity. The first one concerns support schemes. So in Article 4, we state that support schemes can still be provided, but we have moved, but we have enshrined some principles in order to ensure that support will be market-based and cost-effective. So this will mean that the support schemes will be provided through a restricted set of designs, and namely, tenders will be at the heart of allocating these supports. Nevertheless, I would like to highlight this will not replace the need for notification to DG Comp of individual schemes. Okay, but so this is one of the important aspects. Changing support schemes, which now were just a national base. Today, we already have a lot of experience on what are the support schemes which are more cost effective. And so this is what we want to enshrine and want to member states to adopt, to have tenders, the tendering of support on a mainstreaming basis. The second provision I would like to highlight is that we have introduced a provision which will oblige member states to give visibility of their support schemes to investors. So member states will have to publish the support that they plan to provide or that they will plan to tender within a 3-year cycle. This will include the budget, what type of technologies, and so on. This is also very important. The third very important provision, I think this is one of the provisions that investors will be very important for investors, is that we have also introduced a new Article 6, which ensures the stability of financial support, meaning that once support is provided, member states cannot change the support, putting in a form that there are retroactive changes. So what I mean is that member states will not be allowed to change the level of support that they have committed to, affecting or bringing a negative economic impact to the investors. Another important aspect, which has also been introduced in the new directive, is the opening of support schemes to cross-border participation. So as I mentioned earlier, we saw that our impact assessment showed that that opening support to EU-wide on an EU-wide basis could imply a lot of savings. And so we have introduced a provision which states that 10% of the support allocated on a yearly basis by member states, 10% of this support will have to be opened to generators installed in other member states. 10% is the target until 2025, and after 25, the opening this this target is increased to 15%, and to 15%. But nevertheless, after in 2025, this assess DG Comp and also the Commission will look at how this is working, and there is a possibility to even increase more more this opening of support schemes. So I think these are the basic provisions underlying the changes to support schemes, and I think they are important. And one of so first, member states will continue to be to have support schemes if they are necessary. Secondly, we will have visibility to investors, a three-year period. Third, no retroactive changes, so investors can be confident that, contrary to the past, they will not see their support schemes revised. And fourth, we will ensure and we will promote a more cost-effective deployment of renewables by opening the support schemes to other installations in member states. The second set of provisions, which will also help renewable electricity, have to do with administrative barriers. We have to introduce the concept of one-stop shop. So member states will have to have a one-stop shop ensuring all the requirements and all the permitting process. At the same time, we have introduced time limits. So there is a maximum time limit of 3 years so that the member state or the competent authority can have in order to ensure that the permit granting is assessed, and we have introduced also smaller, more flexible and simpler limits and notification procedures for small-scale renewables and repowering. Just for a question, just to give you an example, why are we doing this? Well, just for you to know, the one-stop shop is based on a French experience. They introduced a one-stop shop for so-called ECPE projects, and this allowed them to reduce the average permitting duration from 431 days to 259. And also, we are introducing the time limits for the permitting grants, because in our impact assessment, we found out that 15% of the development costs of an onshore wind project can be attributed to this delays in getting the permitting. As I mentioned, one of the cornerstones of our clean energy package is empowering the consumer, is to give a fair deal to the consumers, as they have a very high potential, not only to decarbonize our energy system, but to help on the demand response and on the flexibility of the and on flexible and on integrating the variables renewables. So what do we want? We want to give the consumer the right to consume, generate, and produce. And the provisions we propose are the following. Renewable self-consumers are allowed to generate, store, sell, and consume their own electricity. And this provision will be mirrored in the Electricity Directive. Renewable self-consumers in multifamily houses will also be allowed to generate, store, sell, and consume their electricity jointly. We have also introduced that these rights that we are conferring to consumers should not be subject to disproportionate procedures, even though charges even though self-consumers should be charged in accordance with their consumption. They just should not have charges which are not cost-reflective. We also have, sorry. Specific provisions for energy communities. So we have similar provisions for energy communities. And why? Because we have seen that energy communities can be a very effective way to bring down deployment costs in order that they will allow, for instance, the access to the best locations. They will reduce permitting they will reduce the time for obtaining the permitting. And we have also enforced the guarantees of origin for better consumer information. So guarantees of origin will now be obligatory for green energy. And we have also extended this to the heating and cooling sector. Moving now to the heating and cooling sector, what is at stake? As I had already mentioned, the heating and cooling sector represents 50% of energy consumption, 18% of renewables today, when, according to our impact assessment, a 27% of heating and cooling of renewables in heating and cooling would be the cost-effective way to achieve our target. And at the same time, the heating and cooling is a sector which is the main responsible for EU's gas imports. It accounts for 68% of EU's gas imports. And so if we have no action, we will miss our target. And also, in terms of security of supply and diversification of our energy sources, it is very important that we decarbonize the heating and cooling, especially in the eastern countries, which have district heating and they cannot. It is very difficult for them to change or to move away from fossil fuels, since these are locked up, they have the locked up with fossil fuels. They become very fragile to the import of gas, and so this is also one of the reasons why this sector is so important to decarbonize. So how do we address this untapped potential of heating and cooling? Well, first we revised certain definitions, regulations and codes regarding buildings in order to also to reduce administrative procedures and to ensure that minimum levels of renewables are integrated in buildings. But we introduced two new articles. Article 23, which ensures that or requests that member states shall endeavor to increase the share of RES heating and cooling by 1 percentage point per year. And this is to be achieved through three types of measures, but the main one is by incorporating renewables in the energy supplied to heating and cooling. So by increasing 1% in the energy sales of renewables share. The other type of measures can, for instance, if member states would prefer direct mitigation measures, would be, for instance, to install very efficient renewables installations in residential, for instance. Member states are also given the flexibility on who they will impose this 1 percentage point increase, meaning that they can cover, they do not need to cover all energy suppliers. They can, for instance, limit, they can exempt, for instance, small and medium companies. And so there, this is the flexibility. And we have also introduced Article 29, which aims to unlock the district heating, by ensuring that consumers are informed of the energy performance of district heating and what is the share of renewables, by enabling consumers to disconnect if they have an alternative where they can achieve a higher performance. And this Article 24 also obliges district heating systems to be opened to integrate renewables and waste energy from other suppliers. So we are opening up the market. Moving now to transport. Transport is also a very challenging sector. It represents 32% of final energy consumption, and it still relies on 94% of its energy needs on oil. And the greenhouse emissions of the sector have not been decreasing. They remain higher today than in 1990. Electrification is expected to strongly contribute to the decarbonization of the sector, especially for passenger cars and light vehicles, while biofuels will continue to be necessary and for aviation and heavy-duty vehicles. Therefore, we need to have more renewable electricity and liquid renewable fuels, including biofuels, to replace oil in transport. So what are we proposing? Well, we propose to introduce an energy-based obligation requiring European transport fuel suppliers to sell a gradually increasing share of renewable and low-emission fuels, starting from 1.5 in 2021 to 6.8 by 2030. And the proposed obligation, what does it cover? Well, it does not cover crop conventional fuels. It covers advanced biofuels produced from feedstock, which are included in an Annex 9 of Part A of our directive, and biofuels from organic wastes and residues with mature technologies, as included in Annex 9 of Part B of our Renewables Directive. To foster specifically innovation in advanced biofuels, their contribution within the overall obligation is ring-fenced, meaning that fuel suppliers have to supply a minimum share of 3.6 advanced biofuels by 2030, starting by 0.5 in 2021. The contribution from biofuels and biomethane produced from feedstock listed in Annex 9, Part B, will be capped to 1.7% due to limited feedstock supply and to mitigate the risk of fraud. We also have introduced a cap on food-based biofuels. Given the ILUC risk, the Commission is of the view that conventional biofuels should no longer be supported after 2020. And so from a cap of 7% in 2021, we impose a linear trajectory, and we will have a maximum 3.8% of conventional biofuels in 2030, meaning that no more than 3.8% will be able to contribute to the renewables target. Okay. Our proposal also addresses bioenergy. Bioenergy plays a key role towards meeting the 2020 and 2030 climate and energy objectives of the EU, delivering benefits in terms of security of supply, growth and jobs, technology innovation, and climate change. However, there are some risks. The risks of the climate performance of bioenergy, that it may have more greenhouse emissions, the environmental impacts on biodiversity, soil, and air quality, and the increasing competition for biomass resources, driven chiefly by combustion of large volumes of biomass in low-efficient installations. So our impact assessment has come up with a revised bioenergy sustainability framework. So what do we propose? Well, we propose to move away from a sustainability criteria based on end use, but rather focus on the raw materials. So this means that the land sustainability criteria will not only apply to biofuels, but also to biomass and biogas. And we have also introduced a new risk-based sustainability criteria for forest biomass, as well as a greenhouse emissions requirement for ensuring proper carbon accounting of carbon impacts of forest biomass used in energy generation. So this means that for agriculture, biomass, so raw material, this will be applied, as I said, to biofuels, biomass, and biogas. Forest biomass will be based on a new risk-based criteria. And then we will also have end-use performance criteria on greenhouse emissions, meaning biofuels and bioliquids. The savings will be increased to 70% for new installations. And for heat and electricity from biomass, this will only be applicable to plants or to installations greater than 20 megawatts fuel capacity greater than 20 megawatts, and to biogas with greater than 0.5 megawatt electricity megawatts. And what are these requirements? Well, the requirements are to have at least 80% greenhouse emission savings for new plants in 2021, which should be increased by 85% in 2026. We also request that biomass plants with a capacity greater than 20 megawatts, they should use very efficient cogeneration technology in order to count against the EU RES target and be eligible for support. Just for you to know that with these thresholds of 20 megawatt fuel capacity and 0.5 megawatts, we are covering 75% of total wood chip consumption, while it only concerns 16% of companies. And finally, to end my presentation, how will we make it happen? Achieving at least 27% renewables EU-wide. Well, This is established in the governance regulation. Member states will have to report their national action plans with what they intend to deploy and implement until 2030 by 2019. And the Commission will monitor on a two-year basis if the member states are performing well, and if not, the EU will ask member states by issuing recommendations or taking EU-level measures, will ask them to take such measures in order that we can bridge the gap filler. I would also like to mention that the 2020 targets will be set as the baseline for the whole period. So this means that even though we do not have a target, specific member state targets, member states will not be allowed to fall below the renewables target that they have for 2020. If they fall below, they will be obliged to play into this financing platform in an amount which is not yet decided, but which should be equivalent to the fact of replacing the energy that bridges the gap towards the maintenance of the target. Okay, so this is the presentation of the main measures. I am sorry, I know this is very specific and technical. It is sometimes difficult to give a more overarching perspective, but please feel free to ask questions and I'll try to answer them. And if not, I can come back afterwards.
Okay. Thank you, Sofia. Thank you for your detailed and in-depth presentation of the RES directive and the proposal of the European Commission. Now we have time for debate, so if you have some question and you want to address to the speaker, please. Any question? Carlos, thank you.
Thank you very much for your clear and complete presentation. I have a comment and a question with regard to the governance of this situation, because as we are seeing, the targets for renewables are global targets for the Union. We have stronger capabilities for the, let's say, the European regulator through ACER, but also we have the capabilities for member states. How do you foresee the movements from the actual situation for each different part of this triangle in terms of to implement in a factual way what is expected in the demand?
Well, as I say, first of all, the member states already in 2019, they will have to set out their national action plans of how they will implement this clean energy package towards achieving the various targets which are established in the package. And when establishing these plans, the Commission will be looking at what the Member States is proposing and will also be looking at what all other member states are proposing. And so the Commission will have a crucial role in ensuring that if there is a delivery, if there is, for instance, already an ambition gap, the Commission, through an iterative process, will go back to the member state, and also because the Commission, as you know, has impact assessments and has information on what would be the potential for the various member states. So the Commission, with this in mind, will go back to the member states and say, please, you have to be more ambitious here. In the end, if I think that from this iterative process, I think we will be able to achieve or to be ambitious enough to have plans that will allow us to reach our target. If not, the regulation foresees that the EU can take measures and recommend measures that will ensure that the member states will comply with the target. And I would like to say the following. The member states, they have committed to achieve the 27% target in a collective way. So this is the responsibility not of a single member state, but of all of us. And so if they are not able to achieve with this current framework, then something is wrong and something will have to change. And I would also like to just to mention, I didn't mention, also very important, is that in the governance, one of the provisions which that is set is that member states should cooperate with other member states. So they should foster the regional cooperation. So this is also a very important aspect, because as we are collectively trying to achieve the target, this interaction with other member states will also create an opportunity for member states to establish how to, what is the best way, what is the potential in order to reach this target in a more cost-effective way. So this is part of one of the requirements established in the governance. Okay.
But in terms of the regulatory framework, if we are looking for these global targets, but also the capabilities and responsibility for each member state to fix, for example, taxation or the definition of the support systems, would we be expecting some kind of harmonization from the European Commission, from the developments of the directives in terms of establish which could be a more homogeneous rules for this regulatory framework that could be introduced in the different member states? Or will we continue with this free situation to give each national regulation to develop their own petitions and take their own decisions?
That is not clearly defined in the governance regulation, but I would say that member states collectively, they will have to decide on what type of measures they want to impose to bridge the gap. And so here we present three type of measures, which are increasing, for instance, or making it obligatory, the heating and cooling provision that we have in the Renewables Directive, increasing the incorporation obligation that we have, for instance, for biofuels. Or we also have the possibility of making a contribution to this financial platform. And through this financial platform, member states may decide. And this would involve deploying with the money that we would have in this financial platform, would involve, for instance, deploying in a cost of tendering, for instance, the increase of the tendering capacity throughout the EU. Okay, but it is not. But I understand that it is not clearly defined. If it's, but I think that it would be the member state as a whole that would have to decide what type of measures they will want to put. And I would also like to say that the Commission, that the governance regulation, states that, nevertheless, when setting these measures for bridging the gap, the ambitions of the or the ambitions showed by member states when pledging their initial targets should be taken into account. Okay, so this is a way so that we should not to have the ones who are performing well and who have been ambitious, they should also be compensated for others which might not have been so ambitious.
Another question. Carlos, please, Carlos Martín.
Thank you very much. Let me first of all congratulate for your very illustrative presentation. My question is on the renewables in the transport sector. Mm-hmm. You have mentioned at the very beginning of your presentation that one of the drivers for your proposal was to, for IOC, effects from biofuels to be mitigated, which I find perfectly reasonable. But what one might think that your proposal, in order to reduce the contribution of conventional, of crop-based biofuels, mm-hmm. with any further consideration of what's the feasibility of every biofuels outlet in order to comply with sustainability criteria, mm-hmm. could be a little bit too inflexible in order to get these renewables targets in transportation to be met. My question is, what do you think? What would be your opinion on our approach based on the ability of biofuels pathways in order to comply with sustainability criteria, increasingly demanding sustainability criteria, regardless of which is the feedstock they are made of?
I'm not sure if I understood totally the question, but what we have is that today, for 2020, the maximum that crop-based biofuels, they can only represent 7%. And we propose to phase this out. And as far as I understand, you are asking how can we increase also... No?
What to change the approach, not to make any differentiation between the feedstock and the biofuels are made of, but the ability of every pathway to meet the sustainability criteria. If you would want biofuels to be sustainable, mm-hmm. let's make this sustainability framework as demanding as we want it to be, and let's not make any differentiation between if it's made from one feedstock or another different feedstock.
As far as I understand, the food-based crops, the crop-based fuels, which we are not incorporating in the incorporation obligation, these are not incorporated there because of their ILUC risks. And in our proposal, we have followed the ILUC approach. And so while we are reducing these food crop-based biofuels, what we are trying is to promote the advanced biofuels, which will promote innovation. I think it's okay.
Thank you.
One question regarding somehow governance. Is considered as a whole like a four package, have the name as clean energy package for all European, but we have usually three packages, energy packages, and many years after those packages, the last the third package, 2009, 2007, 2008, 2009 was published, there are still some infringement procedures to many member states, because that package is not fully implemented. So the question is, to which extent these four packages, are there new or additional or special enforcement operations as to prevent the member states from implementing timely this package? Are there special provisions or is just the, let's say,
business as usual? I would say, as far as I'm aware, but as you saw, the package contains many, many pages, but as far as I'm aware, there are no special provisions. So if a member state is not implementing or is failing to implement a certain target or a certain obligation, it will follow the usual procedures of the Commission, okay?
So, and then the second question is, by what you expect this full package, including all directives and regulations and everything, all communications, by when you expect this will be fully
operation. Well, the ambition of the Commission is to adopt it until the end of this year. That is the ambition of the Commission. But of course, now it is being negotiated with the Council. After the Council, it will have to go to the Parliament. Then from the Parliament, it will go again to the Council. And so this is a process we cannot, I cannot say when it will be adopted. I would just say that it is the ambition of the Commission to adopt it until the end of the year. Okay, even so, because as you know, there are provisions in the governance regulation which should already be implemented at the beginning of 2018. So member states should present their draft national action plans until 2030 by the beginning of 2018.
Ambitious. Any other question?
Thanks a lot, Dr. Smith, for a great presentation. I have two questions regarding the convention is at the heart of most schemes in Europe nowadays, which is standards. On the one hand, do you think that would be visible to implement some type of harmonization some of the standards in the options taking place in Europe today? That's my first question. On the other hand, the second question is, given that options are at the heart of support schemes now, in the future, do you think that they are meeting the expectations? Do you think that the options which have been organized EU-wide have been providing effective and cost-effective support for the regions?
Okay, well, regarding a first question, in our proposal, we say that we want to enshrine market principles and a cost-effective way of allocating support. So by saying this, and also by saying that we want to promote more the tendering of support, I think this will lead us to a more restricted set of support schemes that will be allowed in the future. Second, I would also like to mention, as I had highlighted, that nevertheless, the support schemes will still have to follow the state aid guidelines, and so they will still have to, comply with these guidelines, which, by the way, will be reviewed by the end of 2029. Okay, so nevertheless, the enshrining of the market principles was made taking into account what the state aid guidelines already says, and the idea is exactly to give to member states how they should design their support schemes in order that, in principle, they will be allowed. Secondly, when you say if we are happy, well, I think that this year we have achieved very good results in terms of auctions. The Kriegers Flak with the 50 euro per megawatt hour for wind, and also in Holland with, I think, another auction which we achieved also for wind, 72 euros per megawatt hour. So I think that this year we have seen results in auctions which are very, very promising and which show that renewables are here to stay and are competitive. Okay.
Last question. Rafael,
thank you, Sofia, for your presentation. I have a comment regarding the support schemes.
Okay.
When you say the stability of the financial support, but with the worst cases that we have in our experience, with no retroactive changes for future. But that could be a necessary regulatory protection for all the technologies, not only for the renewables. because when you invest in smart grids, you invest in storage and the rest of the key elements that you need in terms of the balancing needed for future equilibrium of the mix, is preferred to announce the stability for framework regulatory for future to defend all the investors, not only a new entrant investors in a part of the technology that we desire to increase a lot the share, but it's not the only final solution of all the elements of the energy.
Yes, I agree with you. I think that, well, first in the Renewables Directive, we can only talk about the stability of the renewable support. Second, I agree with you that today, if we want to have renewables, it's not only about deploying more renewables, but it's also of, we also have to have the infrastructure and also batteries, storage, and so on, supporting the deployment of renewables. And so these investments are also very important. What I can say is that the EU has a wide set of instruments, financial instruments, and programs and initiatives which aim to help the deployment of other type of infrastructure. So for instance, you also have PCIs. PCIs can also be for energy storage. You have FC, which in our proposal, FC is the is the Juncker plan. And we have made the revision of its proposal in order that in FC2, 40% of the investments made through FC should be climate related. And so this also opens up the scope. Then we will have, for instance, the Innovation Fund after 2020. The Innovation Fund is the follow-up of the NER 300 program. And in the Innovation Fund, we will be supporting renewables, but also in energy intensive industries, and also for instance, infrastructure for electricity vehicles. So we in our so that is what I want to say. We do not have a specific regulation ensuring the stability of investments for other type of infrastructure. But what we have is an enabling framework, and we are trying to put in place through EU funds the right financial instruments to address investment uncertainty, further risk, and so on. Okay? Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Yo creo que ya sería el momento de ir clausurando el acto y pediríamos a la directora de la Cátedra de Sostenibilidad Energética si puede dirigir las palabras de clausura del seminario. Gracias.
Muchas gracias. Thank you very much for your splendid, complete conference. Creo que el paquete, el Winter Package, implica un cambio similar al que supuso la directiva del 96, no por reducir la importancia de la directiva del 2003 o la del 2009, pero en definitiva el 2003-2009 no vinieron sino a profundizar el cambio sustancial de la primera directiva, que es la que supuso un cambio de modelo. Un cambio de modelo que implicó el desarrollo de un mercado liberalizado con unas exigencias que yo creo que han dado sus frutos a lo largo de todos estos años. ¿Cuál sería el cambio que supone el Winter Package? Aunque el mercado interior de la energía no es algo que aparezca de nuevo con el Winter Package, sí que creo que el Winter Package recoge como un objetivo más allá de la energía el mercado interior de la energía. Porque una de las cuestiones, aunque esto veremos si se mantiene en el Parlamento, una de las cuestiones nuevas y trascendentales es que a la lectura de las diferentes propuestas que se recogen en ese paquete, que si lo dijéramos, lo midiéramos por páginas o por peso, aún sería más impactante que en la slide de toda la documentación, es que no parece que se vaya a someter al artículo de energía del Tratado de Roma, sino que pasa a ser parte competencial de mercado interior, para lo cual ya no se requiere la unanimidad. Y esto es, yo diría, lo más trascendental respecto a la efectividad real y materialización de la propuesta, más allá de los cambios que puede haber en el Parlamento. Cierto es que el Parlamento es soberano para cambiar este objetivo de que sea materia de mercado interior y vuelva a tratarse los temas de energía dentro de lo que es el artículo que contempla esta temática, este ámbito. Y por lo tanto sería mucho más complejo la materialización. Pero este es un aspecto enormemente importante y que creo que debe enfocarse y analizarse desde todos los países y sectores afectados como un elemento de fuerza mucho mayor de los que tuvieron las anteriores propuestas de la Comisión. Y el Winter Package en realidad no debe sorprendernos esta voluntad, porque el avanzar, porque nunca se acaba, creo que Fukuyama no tuvo razón cuando decía que la historia se acababa, nunca se acaba, el querer dar armazón al Winter Package es, digamos, el paso lógico después de los avances del propio paquete del 2009 y después de la creación de un solo algoritmo desde mayo del 2014, que el Eufemia, para todos los mercados de energía. ¿Pero qué más cosas nos reserva el Winter Package? Evidentemente, las energías renovables pasan a ser, digamos, la fuente energética fundamental y sobre la que descansa toda la propuesta de este paquete energético. Pero no es solamente esto. Para facilitar el desarrollo de las energías renovables, que no se produzcan situaciones de ineficiencia asignativa o de ineficiencia técnica, las interconexiones pasan a tener un papel relevante, fundamental, en esta propuesta. Y a través de esa importancia de las interconexiones, la Comisión en el Winter Package nos dice que el enfoque común respecto a cómo supervisar esas interconexiones y, en realidad, el conjunto de los aspectos que están relacionados con el mercado interior es la creación de un único regulador europeo, que así lo plantea, pero que por el momento ese único regulador europeo, a la luz de la efectividad que pueden tener todavía los reguladores nacionales y de su papel en el Consejo de CER, y como asesores, por lo tanto, de ACER, hasta 2021 se mantiene una situación transitoria. Creo que este es un aspecto muy importante porque, en realidad, pienso que es la primera vez con este paquete que se avanza como se ha avanzado en otros sectores, por ejemplo, en el financiero, hacia un modelo de supervisión único en Europa y hacia una cierta pérdida de soberanía razonable con una voluntad de una Unión Europea. Se crean, además, en el entretanto, unos niveles institucionales intermedios que va a afectar mucho a los TSO, que son estos coordinadores regionales, y además hay una voluntad un poco todavía por definir de armonización de las tarifas y de un nuevo papel de los DSO, porque los DSO, en definitiva, son los que van a tener que gestionar las evacuaciones, los problemas de congestión de las evacuaciones de las renovables, porque son, a excepción de algunas grandes evacuaciones de viento, ¿no? de energía de molinos de viento, es decir, lo que es el wind energy, el resto de la energía suele, incluso dentro del sector del viento, una buena parte de él evacua a distribución, creándose enormes problemas de congestión que no han sido hasta ahora posibles de ser resueltos por los DSO. Los DSO es un nuevo papel que tienen que adquirir y que se les concede esa importancia en el Winter Package. Y también, como se ha señalado, un aspecto también muy novedoso es el de la organización local, ¿no?, de la generación y de la distribución de energía. En definitiva, yo creo que nos encontramos posiblemente frente a un reto igual de importante que encontró, que tenía el sector en el año 96, y falta ver que el Consejo se sienta tan cómodo como todos aquellos que creemos que el mercado único es una buena solución. Veremos qué dicen los países. Algunos, he oído, algunos gobiernos han manifestado una cierta frialdad. Pero esperemos que lo que nos ha presentado hoy la ponente se materialice rápidamente en una directiva aprobada y aplicable. Muchas gracias.